Welcome to the first Sheng Yan lecture series in Chinese Buddhist Studies. The Sheng Yan Buddhist Studies lecture series was established in 2011 in conjunction with the establishment of the Sheng Yan Professorship in Chinese Buddhist Studies and the Sheng Yan Graduate Student Fellowship. The lecture series supports annual lectures, workshops, conferences by visiting scholars at Florida State. Sheng Yan, who passed away in 2009, was one of the most influential Buddhist scholars and monks in the modern world, dividing his time between the United States and Taiwan. This lecture series honors his work by providing opportunities and furthering academic lectures on all aspects of Chinese Buddhism in promotion of Buddhist studies. We're delighted to have with us Dr. Daniel Stevenson of University of Kansas to begin the first of this annual series of lectures. Dan is a dear friend and a mentor to me when I first began academic studies of Chinese Buddhism. And it's also quite appropriate that he has known Master Sheng Yan since mid-70s when he was a grad student. So I really wanted to get him to be the first scholars to augment this series of talks. It took us 2 years waiting on his schedule to open up.
Buddhist time.
Dr. Stevenson is the chair of the Department of Religious Studies at University of Kansas. He received his PhD from Columbia University in 1987. Over the years, he has published numerous articles and co-authors on influential monographs in Chinese Buddhism, making him the authority on Chinese Tiantai Buddhism. He also has two forthcoming monographs on Song Dynasty, Pure Land Practices, and Religious Monastic Rituals. We look forward to reading them. His research interests include the performative and cultural aspects of Buddhist ritual exegetical institutional practices in China, particularly as exercised in Tiantai and Pure Land circles during the medieval late imperial periods. He's also interested in the construction of Buddhist identities and values in relation to a larger field of Chinese religious options. And this afternoon, he will venture on a new area of Chinese Buddhist studies in the 19th century with a talk on the remapping of Buddhism as a world religion, Gyonen's essentials of eight sects, the Hasshu, koyo, and modernist East Asian agenda. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Dan Stevenson.
Thank you. Thank you, Jimmy. That's far too kind. And thank you all for having me here. It really is a special honor to be asked to be the inaugural speaker for this lecture series. As Jimmy mentioned, I'm humbled by that. As Jimmy mentioned, I did have the great pleasure to meet Master Sheng Yan many years ago, and as a grad student, studied with him in New York over years, and also had the good fortune to study for a time in one of his Buddhist institutes in Taiwan, which was modeled on very concepts that I'm going to talk about today. Okay. So as a gesture of gratitude to him, this talk ventures into an area that is not altogether familiar to me, this topic of Gyonen's Hasshu Koyo and the formation of sort of modernist Buddhist agendas, agendas of Buddhists who saw themselves as reformers of this age-old tradition in the period of largely the end of the 19th century through the early 1920s. World was in considerable turmoil. Okay. Sheng Yan himself is a product of that era, and that's reflected very much in the discourses, globalized discourses of Buddhism, I would add, that all of us have been encountering in our own lives. Now, this is a tale, I have to say, that I didn't go looking for. This text and the story I'm about to tell you is not something that I typically research. I work on a much earlier period. But this is something that I kind of backed into in part as a result of my own personal experience and the circumstances of my life as a graduate student and my studies since then. So it intrigued me, and I put this together and delivered it on several occasions for talks similar to this one. But it's especially pertinent to this one. And I think it's a most curious tale that I'm about to tell. And it becomes all the more intriguing because I expect it is not unique to the story of the Buddhist tradition in East Asia, but finds parallels in other traditions confronted with an emerging modernity, okay, and challenged to negotiate their place as a religion, and I put religion in quotation marks, therein, because religion was not a term that most of these traditions used within their own discourses. So the talk at hand involves this discovery, in a word, of an obscure Buddhist text called The Essentials of the Eight Sects, the Hasshu Koyo. It's authored in 1268 by a medieval Japanese Buddhist monk by the name of Gyonen. And it's a tale about the subsequent elevation of this obscure text, not only in Japan, but across East Asia at large, and even through those auspices to the West, as a foundational narrative for representing Buddhism as a religion among the world's diverse religions. Quotation marks around religion and religions again, okay? So let's sketch a little bit of background to this. The period in which this development takes place extends from the latter decades of the 19th century into the first half of the 20th century. This is the really formative era, and it's a time of huge transition. The setting is chiefly China and Japan here, though Europe and even South Asia figure substantively into the mix, as we shall see. The decades in question saw the intersection of three important factors that forever changed the landscape of Buddhist institutions in these regions. It changed their clergy, their ecclesiastica, and their traditions, their teachings as well throughout East Asia. One of those factors, and these will probably be familiar to most of you, one of those factors was the jettisoning of traditional forms of governance in these regions, China and Japan, for example, and a transition to constitutional forms of governance in the image of the modern nation state. And that expression, nation-state, or the translingual equivalent thereof, 国家, in Japanese, 国家, in Chinese, is formed at that time as well, in accompanying this transition. Another factor of this period was the implementation by government policy and law of a division between religion and the secular, and this is an utterly fascinating story. And subsequent to that, the active promotion of the ideal of a secular society. So they're taking a religion, a society in which those distinctions had never been made, at least not articulated in the same way perhaps as we might, you know, in the post-Enlightenment period. Decide what's religion and what's secular, and then everybody has to scurry for cover accordingly. So religion has to define itself accordingly, the secular has to define itself accordingly, okay? Third factor was the keen perception in this historical period of historical transition that this was a transition to a modern age, from an antiquated past to a modern age and a globalized age. And this was an age of connected with the promises of, you know, of the eschatology of science, technological progress, social progress, guided by a rational humanism. And all of this stuff is pouring into China and Japan at this time, okay? Is in large part due to encounters with the West, hostile and otherwise, okay? Not only Asians going to Europe and England to study, but of course there was the presence of an imperialistic and expanding Europe and the West into China and into Japan, as we shall talk about later. Now, this concept of world religion, as we mentioned in the title, part and parcel with this discourse of modernity came hitherto unknown category of religion. Okay? Very familiar to us, not so much to them. With its 2,000-year-old history, its rich collection of canonical literatures and exegetical traditions, its well-established monastic institutions and clergy, Buddhists in East Asia had their own well-hewn locutions for objectifying themselves as a distinctive tradition. Okay? They use the term jiao or kyo in Japanese, jiao in Chinese, which basically carries the sense when accompanied with the word Buddha, Fuo Jiao, Kyo, as the teaching or authoritative teaching of the Buddha, okay? And institutions clearly associated with that. Another term that was saw traditional use was a term known as zong, shu in Japanese, which in many cases is rather innocuous and carries the sense of a core tenet or the sense of a philosophical persuasion, perhaps, you know, school, we might say. But also, at various points and places, gets highly institutionalized in ways we would call sect, as an exclusive order of some kind. Okay? So, cobbled together in late 19th century Japan, that's where we think this neologism developed, it formed the neologism zongjiao, shugyo, out of those two traditional terms. The new term zongjiao, or shugyo, was used to render translingually the metacategory of religion or religious. Now, this is probably all familiar story to students of Jimmy. And with that neologism came an entirely new and alien discursive field, a set of distinctions, a meta-discourse, if you will, within which indigenous East Asian traditions such as Buddhism were compelled to redefine themselves. And this is a world, a new field of world religions. Religion is a universal human category that's been identified, collected in every culture and region imaginable. So it's a new universe in which Buddhism finds itself operating. So whether these distinctions and changes came with enthusiastic embrace or out of defensive response to the socio-political terrain that was shifting quite literally beneath the feet of Buddhists in East Asia, advocates of Buddhist reform, or literally Buddhist modernization, xianaihua, gendaika, you know, in East Asia turned to Gyonen's essentials as a template to articulate their place as a religion among the world's religions set within this emerging modern age. Of all things, 13th century text, totally obscure, gets picked up and brought out as a kind of narrative template for articulating the place as a Buddhist tradition, a larger field of Buddhist traditions, and also within the world of world religions. As a footnote to this point, it bears stressing that this exchange was not simply a bilateral Buddhist response to an aggressive imperial West, as this is so often presented. It entailed thorny, multi-directional responses of Buddhists to Buddhists on the local scene, negotiations of Buddhist identities to regional, ethnic, and now newly emerging national identities in Japan, and responses to established Buddhist institutions to newly emerging regimes of political authority, you know, in this division between religion and secular. So it is these agendas, okay, of Buddhists to Buddhists in many cases, not just Buddhists to the West, that I want to talk about and try to delineate in this talk. Now, odd as it may seem, there is a wonderfully fortuitous connection between Gyonen's Hasshu Koyo, the essentials, and Venerable Shengyan, as we shall see. Venerable Shengyan being the man for whom this lecture series is named. And I'd add also that my own entry into the field of Buddhist studies and connection to Master Shengyan is involved in this story as well, which is why I come to it. Indeed, it's by dint of this experience that I happen to back into the topic of Gyonen's text, actually, and its importance. And it's a gesture to Master Shengyan. And to lend a little bit more poignancy to this talk, I'd like to sort of sketch out for you that backstory a little bit and see what you think, partly. So I've just given you a bit of a conspectus of where we're headed here, okay? There's a lot of good bit of technical detail at certain places in this story. I'll try to work through it with you, and I hopefully have highlighted the things that will keep you on the railroad track, so at least we'll get a kind of thread that runs through it that may stick by the time we get to the end. This is a picture taken of a place called the Dajue Si, the Dajue Monastery in the Bronx. It was an abandoned old telephone building that was converted into a Chinese Buddhist monastery and it's been a kind of cultural center for regional laity. There were 5 monks in residence there at this period of time. Also, various events would be held there. The monks were there every day, And this is where I met Master Sheng Yan in 1976, and where I would go up and read with these fellows and study with some of these fellows and so on and so forth, including Master Sheng Yan, of course. Okay? Patronized by Chinese, by very, very prominent and not prominent Chinese laity who would show up on weekends. That's Bob Thurman, left at the center, in the back row there, as some of you will know. When I was a student, one of the key things that I encountered in my studies, like a lot of students of my generation, was my principal contact with Buddhism came through books and came through college courses, university courses, right? It was in the wind in the late 60s and early 70s. Books were circulating around, like the Tibetan Book of the Dead and various things like that, D.T. Suzuki. And it's texts like these that we sort of began to develop an interest, to begin to even map that tradition, you know, on the landscape. I came into contact with Buddhism through those very means, and when I got to college, through college courses. And one work in particular stands out as a staple of college syllabi and bibliographies on the subject. And that's a book called The Essentials of Buddhist Philosophy, authored by Takakazu Junjiro, a Japanese scholar, edited by Wingsit Chan and Charles Moore. Now, I will say more about this text later, so I'm not going to launch into it here. But I've given you a few notes here, that it was used for the first international East-West conference in Hawaii back in the 30s. This is before the war. Okay. Now, this Essentials is presented by Takakazu as a sweeping history of Buddhism from its origins in India through China in its golden age in Tang period China, which produced these great Buddhist schools of Huayin and Tiantai and Pure Land. On into Japan that saw further development of some of those Chinese, distinctive Chinese articulations of Buddhism, and then producing their own transformations in Japan, various Pure Land subsects in Japan, Jodo-shu, Jodo-shinshu, and the Nichiren tradition of school, which sort of grew out of Tendai. Okay? So after the sweeping introduction of the spread of Buddhism from the homeland in India through China into this terminus of Japan, the remaining 11 of the book's 15 chapters are each dedicated to discussion of the basic literatures, historical origins, or lineage, and philosophy of a particular Buddhist sect or school, Shu. Okay? The central emphasis is placed on the great schools of Indian Mahayana, the ones that survived and prospered in East Asia, at least as textual repositories, but especially these unique syntheses that emerged in Tang period China and then continued to develop and birth new other traditions later in Japan. Okay? So there's a kind of a vector at work here in this history that points to a sort of terminus through China and into Japan. Okay? It is precisely Takakazu's vision of Buddhist thought and its history imbibed through his essentials that in 1976 I brought as a fledgling graduate student in Buddhist studies to my encounters with monks at the Dajrasu. I was a pain in the ass to them, I have a fear, because I would pose questions to them and they would occasionally wince and caution, you know, about these 10 or 12 odd sects, and do you know about the Hawaiian sect, and do you know about the Tendai sect, and what can you tell me about them? And they kind of like, we don't emphasize these distinctions that much, and everything sounded like they were resistant to those distinctions and more interested in a kind of compromise, okay? They weren't too enthused with those emphases. But at the same time, I took little note of their reservations. And indeed, these guys were fully conversant in all the sundry literatures, doctrinal distinctions, and nomenclatures peculiar to this world of sectarian differentiation that I brought to our discussions. So what they confirmed to me, you know, it was sufficiently familiar with this and seemed sufficiently natural to reinforce my impressions that the distinctions themselves were perfectly natural, kind of like a natural language, you know? They confirmed in my imagination their received fact or established reality of Buddhist history, that what I was talking about was the way it really was in East Asia, rather than its retrospective literary or discursive representation. Oh, how interesting, you know about the Kagon sect, or you know about the apostle sect and so on and so forth, and all the titles and all the literatures that I remember. If their interest in sectarian difference was muted, their erudition was incredibly impressive. Although at the time I had no clue who these guys were. Okay? I had no clue who these people were. And these monks, including Venerable Shengyan, were not particularly inclined to volunteer details about their background. They were not self-promoters by any means of the word, let alone broadcast their accomplishments and personal persuasions. So apart from my pressing questions, there was disappointingly little mention of specific sectarian affiliations or interests. Darn, you know, no Chan there, you know, no Huayin or Tian Tai. It was only gradual and some years later that I came to know them, and an impressive lot they were. So let me tell you a little bit about some of these individuals. On the left here is Master Shengyan. One in from the left. Next to him, to the left, is Reverend Renjun. Next to him, in the brown robes, is Minzhi. And next to him, to the left, is Dongchu. And then on the right, far right, a monk by the name of Jing Tong from Hong Kong, who had just ordained not long ago. But the four figures in the middle, Shengyan, Renjun, Minzhi, and Dongzhu, I have no idea who they were, but we'll tell you more about them now. Okay? These are the individuals who I encountered there and had the great fortune to get to know. Minzhi, and this is not going to make too much sense to you, but I've highlighted this to you to just track this, because we'll talk more about this shortly, and I hope the point will become clear. But Minzhi was a student at Minnan and Wuchang Academies, which were established by a reformist monk named Taishu. Okay? And he was a graduate of Wuchang in 1935. I'm not going to go into details of his personal religious training, but he was a Chan master, as we discovered. But in 1938, after his graduation, he was appointed as director of the Tianning Buddhist Academy, the curriculum of which he revised completely, making it one of the most influential modern Buddhist academies in China, period. In 1946 to 49, just before the revolution, he was also promoted to abbot of Tianning Monastery. There he was, living in a telephone, you know, company building the rocks. Dongzhu, who was the man seated in one end from the right, the tallest of the group, was the tantra master of Master Shengyan, but also Dharma master to Master Shengyan, and an extremely important person in his own right. He was a student at Taishu's Minnan Academy, so your name appears also up there, where he possibly, even at that time, might have known Minzhi. In 34 to 36, he did Chan training at Tianning Monastery under the same master from whom Minzhi received Dharma transmission, and becomes abbot of Dingwei Monastery in Jiaoshan, where he also receives Dharma transmission from Zhiguang, a student with Taishu at Yangwei's Jadevang Academy. So you can see this name Taishu and this network of Buddhist academies beginning to tie together here. Around that time, he founds a very important Jiaoshan Academy, a Buddhist academy at Jiaoshan, and is based on these, evidently on these same models. Renjun, 1912 to 2011, was a student at Tianning Buddhist Academy, the one established and reformed by Minzhi, and then went on to Taishu's Minnan Buddhist Academy. He, 43, he returns to Tianning Buddhist Academy and serves as his instructor there, then an instructor at Taishu's Jing'an Buddhist Academy. And it is Jing'an, actually, that Shengyan himself studied, and Renjun was an instructor there during that period of time. Later on, he becomes a disciple of Taishu's influential student, Inshun, who was one of the greatest Buddhist spokespersons for Buddhist reform in Taiwan and contemporary China. Shengyan himself, 47 to 48, was a student at Taishu's Jing'an Academy, and it was Dharma heir to Master Dongzhu, whom we saw. So quite a little network of relationships developing among these individuals who ended up at this place. Now these figures, Taishu and Yang Renshan, or Yang Wenhui, if you've read the seminal works on Buddhism in the modern period, Republican era China, written by Holmes Welch, their names appear everywhere. These are the seminal movers and shakers of Buddhist reform and modernization in the period from the end of the 19th century up really to the present day. Their names appear everywhere. But Taishu actually was, let me start with the man on the right, Yang Wenhui, or Rinshan as his courtesy name has it, established an academy in Nanjing in about 1909 as a modernizing Buddhist academy, at which Taishu was a student, and the master Dongchu, Zhirgua, was a student. They were fellow students. So this is where that model of the sort of reform academy in China begins. Okay? That's Yang Wenhui on the right, Taishu on the left. Now, what's interesting about this story is that what's interesting or really astonishing about these educational scenarios, the experience of me and my contemporaries in English-speaking American universities who were drawn to East Asia Buddhism, and the experience of Sheng Yan's Chinese-speaking monastic peers educated in the Taishu academies of Republican-era China, is that our elemental knowledge of East Asian Buddhist traditions and their history, came largely through an encounter with texts. And in fact, they are genealogically related. I mean, this was an astonishing revelation to me. In effect, we read and studied the same book. Okay? Let me explain. Up above, down below, you see the essentials of Buddhist philosophy, which I encountered, written by Takasu Junjiro, edited in Sichuan. The work, as I mentioned before, produced for comparative discussion of Buddhism as a world religion or philosophy, that in turn disseminated that narrative to countless Americans. And that's the text I studied, and that text, from beginning to end, is modeled on Gyonen's Hasshu koyo, Essentials of the Eight Sects. It's largely just a rewriting of it and an expansion of it. Okay? You can compare the two side by side, and it's unmistakable. And the Essentials of the Eight Sects, as it turns out, or a similar derivative thereof, was used as a primer in the first academy established by Yang Wenhui. And I've since dug up information from surviving curricula of Wuchang Academy, Minnan Academies, and autobiographical accounts of Sheng Yan and Taishu himself, that it was a primer in Taishu's academies as well. So basically, that's how it found its way into American college curriculum, where it served the same function. And that's how we were able to have this conversation, albeit a slightly uncomfortable one, where they could register the questions I was asking, although they were trying to respond in a way that I didn't quite pick up on. That difference in tension has since become more apparent. And that's the story I want to talk about now, is how that meta-narrative filtered through this study and through the narrative established in this text gave not only a model for thinking about Buddhism as East Asian Buddhism as a tradition, you know, as a world religion, but caused a lot of repositioning and negotiation among Buddhists in East Asia. And I'll try to bring that out to you as well. Okay. So now we move on to how a neglected medieval Japanese treatise became a universal Buddhist primer in the state. How did this come about? How did we get to this point? And that's what I'd like to launch in with you now. And I'm going to sweep through this and just point out largely some numbers to you. The PowerPoint I can make available to you if people want to see it and probe it a little bit further, but I'm going to try to economize it here. The picture down below is a copyright waived, literally, 1987 reprint of Gyonen's Hasshu Koyo with commentary of contemporary Japanese scholars. So you can see there was quite a production of literature based on this little text, which I'll talk about in a minute. And copyright waived means that this was meant to be produced and reproduced and reproduced and reproduced all over the place without anybody gaining any personal profit of it, right? So it was aggressive. Japanese discovery and dissemination of Gyonen's texts. Prior to about 1878, there's literally one printing of Gyonen's text that we're aware of, and it was 17th century. It didn't go very far. There are very, very few surviving copies. And it just did not have much of a mark. The text itself, of
course, was written in the 13th century.
So why is it between 1878 and 1924, 15 editions of the original text with commentary were printed in Japan between 1878 and 1909 alone? Okay? These are editions. We're talking not only about Hasshu koyo, but commentaries to that text as well. Six additional editions were produced between 1912 and 1924, and in the 1880s, Gyonen's Essentials is adopted as a primer of Buddhist history and thought in newly founded Japanese Buddhist academies and universities. So this is where it all gets started, is in Japan, by modernizing Buddhist monks in Japan. Okay? So that's a pretty astonishing literary production, and bespeaks enormous interest in this text and great popularity. Now, I have not seen any real research that in those variant editions, but I suspect from what I can tell that many of them were re-editions in the sense of actually expanding on Gyonen's text, repositioning Gyonen's text in various ways, and probably, since there were so many, done so to achieve certain specific maneuvers between Buddhist groups in Japan, not to mention simply the West. So that's a great story to be yet to be told. Updated and expanded surveys of Buddhist history model on Gyonen's Essentials of the Eight Sects were produced as well, in addition to those early commentaries. The history of the short history of the 12 Japanese Buddhist sects, an English version was written by Nanju Bunyu, and an English version translated and edited by Nanju Bunyu. This started out as an ecumenical project by Japanese priests from about five different Buddhist sects, but it was overseen by the Pure Land, Jodo Shinji sect, and edited by a man named Ogurusu Kocho, and I just mark that name because he reappears again several times later in our narrative here. So there's an updated version, ecumenical, of Buddhist traditions trying to represent themselves, but under the Jodo Shinshu Pure Land aegis. Then we have Essentials of the Individual Buddhist Sects in five volumes, a slightly expanded version, I should say. This was a massive endeavor. This was ecumenical as well, again led by Jodo Shinshu Buddhist priests, and an incredibly important modernizer by the name of Shimaji Bokurai, who was responsible literally for establishing the first Buddhist universities in Japan. And six reprints were done in the first year. Four revisions of that collection were done over the next decade. So this is quite an industry. But that's not the end of it, because European translations of some of these works began as soon as the texts hit the market. And this is where it might become particularly interesting of, you know, where we get the connections to Takakusu and begin to get our knowledge of Buddhism. So this was also sort of a missionizing activity. A short history of the 12 Japanese Buddhist sects by, was translated by Nanjo and published in 1886. A French translation of that text, but expanded. And really, when you read it, it's very interesting because it's even far more aggressively missionizing for the Jodo Shinshu, was produced in 1889. Then we get Sukumar Dutt's 10 Schools of Chinese Buddhism, done in 1952, Western surveys of various Western surveys of Buddhism in China and East Asia that referenced this text through and through and through. And you can read the titles there. So the first emergent academic surveys of Buddhism in China and East Asia that were being read in the classroom by missionaries, etc., all listed down below, ending with Ludwig Reichelt's Truth and Tradition in Chinese Buddhism, very important work, reference and footnote this Hasshu koyo and its earlier impact. It is the genesis of, you know, the historical imaginary by which we're seeing Buddhism in East Asia as a world religion. Now, I'm just going to show you these. We're not going through these titles. But Chinese appropriations occur as well, just as we see the European translations. There were, during this period, not a few Chinese monks who were going to Europe to study, but also going to Japan to study. And they were bringing back this model of the modern Buddhist academy and university from Japan and seeking to implement this in China itself. And they were clearly had contact with this Essentials of the Eight Sects, its variant, its derivatives thereof. and began to produce any number of texts based on that model. Two of the first were by Yan Wenhui himself, the man who set up the first Buddhist academy in China. And those are listed above, or three, I should say, by Yan Wenhui. And then Taishin himself wrote two works which are clearly modeled on the narrative of Gyonen's text as well, okay, in addition to using Gyonen's text in his academy. So this gives you a kind of, you know, literary record, you know, I should say, a paper trail for the genealogy of where this text goes. Okay. Additional surveys modeled on Gyonen's essentials. Look at this. This goes right on down to 1963, continuing production of surveys of Buddhism that are the same thing. India to China to Japan, and then chapter after chapter on individual sects, most of which don't survive anymore. And the last one is one of the most interesting. Tang Yongtong writing in 1963, and literally the title of this major article is, there are no 10 sects in Chinese Buddhism. So what are you talking about? So you can see the tensions that are arising around the promotion of this this narrative in Gyonen's text. So let me then reprise here a little bit about the beginnings of this adoption of Gyonen's text and this narrative of Gyonen's into Chinese Buddhist discourse through its academies largely and its literature. Yan Wenhui left behind something called the Intercurriculum for Buddhist Schools, which is basically the Buddhist curriculum for his academy. And he specifies that primer for beginning students will be used for the general education curriculum, and he has some other specifics. And the text titles he's mentioned here are specifically based on Gyonen's Essentials of the Eight Sects. After having an introduction, a foundation in the study of the sweeping history, and these eight or 10 or however many sects are spelled out. When you go on to the next levels of education, the curriculum entails focused study of the core treatises and histories of these different sects or schools. So it's a sect-oriented representation of the Buddhist tradition that has an emphatic place, you know, thrust into a focus on East Asian traditions. Taishu's autobiography mentions that he used a similar text for first-year students in his academies. And I would add to that that Sheng Yan himself mentioned in his autobiography that a text of the Hasshu koyo or derivative thereof was used at the Jing'an Academy when he studied. You know. So that's why he knew so well the things I was talking about. We're educated through use of the same text. So let's step back and what is going on here during this era that's leading to this sudden industry reproducing this text and disseminating its narrative so broadly, the appetite for this. I'm going to be very brief here, but in 1854, really after several hundred years of first encounter with the West, Japan reopens to foreign trade and Christian missionaries. And along with this comes this passionate drive towards modernization in Japan, a study of the West. In 1868, we see the Meiji Restoration with the rise of the constitutional nation state in Japan, which just changes you know, the political and religious landscape irrevocably. In 1871, this gets nasty for Buddhists and ends with a confiscation of Buddhist land holdings, reorganization of Buddhist temples and lineages into, guess what? Sects or schools, okay? The very thing that we see idealized in Gyonen's text. And we see a redefinition of the legal status and privileges of Buddhist clergy and institutions, including marrying monks. Okay. 1872 to 1889, there's a juridical separation of state and religion, the secular and the religious, as I kind of alluded to earlier, which sends religious groups scurrying for cover to properly identify themselves as a religion, or constitute themselves as a religion juridically amenable to a secular state. Okay? China, very, very similar pattern of events. And it's according to much of the same time period. Some encounters with the West, followed by the Sino-Japanese War, which is certainly thrusting modernization into their face. And in 1911-1912, the fall of the Qing dynasty, the last imperial house, and the rise of the Chinese Republic and nation state and constitutional governance, same pattern playing out. 1913, there's a constitutional separation of religion and state, the secular and the religious. And 1898 begins a period of episodic, I should say, confiscation of Buddhist properties to create secular schools. And in 1927-37, rabid anti-superstition campaign, which often targeted many Buddhist practices and traditional customs and festivals and various things like that, okay? So they're obviously that provoked enormous Buddhist responses, both in Japan and in China, okay? So this entails several strategies, one of which, embraced by the Japanese very early, was to seize the initiative. And for many, modernization was not a terrible thing. So quite a few Buddhist priests, especially, note again, by the Jodo Shinshu, were sent to Europe to study. And when you read about this, it's quite interesting. They were sent specifically to examine the relationship between religion and the state, and to look at university curricula and explore this emergent scientific study of religion, which is, of course, what birthed religious studies departments like yours and mine, okay? An academic discipline coming on the scene. 1884 through 86, Nanjo Bunyu, a Japanese Jodo Shin or Pure Land priest, is sent to study Sanskrit with Max Mueller. And if you will know, some of you will remember that Max Mueller was the chief editor for the Sacred Books of the East, which put some of the first major Buddhist treatises, not to mention Confucian, Taoist, and others, and Indic, into Western, you know, English-speaking audiences. And Takakusu Junjiro, a man who wrote The Essentials of the Eight Sects, actually translated some of those works published in that series. So there you can see the connection. But Mueller also was responsible for writing theoretically about and promoting the scientific study of religion. And Nanjo Bunyo translates his introduction to the scientific study of religion into Japanese when he returns to Japan. And word has it, from what I've read by Japanese scholars writing on the subject, it had a major impact on the intellectual landscape. In the 1880s, private universities are established by major Buddhist sects in Japan in order to get on board with this drive towards modernization. Curriculum includes history of Buddhism and the study of religion. So here comes our term, religion. 1889 through 1905, the scientific study of religion is formally established as an academic discipline at Tokyo Imperial University. That's pretty impressive. Outside of what was it, either Oxford or Cambridge, I'm not sure where other university chairs were established in the study of religion at this time period, but that's quite early story, as I recall. Okay. In 1878 through, here come the Chinese, in 1878 through 1884, again in 86 and 89, Na Wan Wei visits Europe, meets Max Mueller and Nanjo Bunyu, and they all become friends. So it's a very small world. And Taishu goes to Japan in 25 and to Europe and the US in 1928-29. So these are global connections that are beginning to emerge here, as some of you. And then in 1904 through 1909, we see the rise of the first Buddhist academies in China as a result of Yang Wenhui's initiatives in Nanjing. So enter the translingual theologians in Zhongjiao, or Shujiao Japanese, this topos of religion and this whole discourse of world religions to which Buddhists are now responding and seeking to reimagine themselves. Okay. This represents a new and shifting field of discourse. And I thought I would just sketch this, outline this. Those of you who are well-trained in religious studies, this will be a very familiar turf to you. But others may be fairly new. And I just want to draw a couple of points to you here about this discursive and discoursive field that's taking shape at this time. On the left here, we see this distinction left and right between the irrational and supernatural versus the rational and empirical. It's a major divide,
constituent part with science and religion. Religion versus the secular. And on the left, we see here, you know, various aspects of that are subcategories or attributes that go into sort of defining something as a religion. You know, this question about presence of scripture, systematic doctrine, belief, you know, identifiable institutions and authority, ethics, you know, with social progressive morality, and then a series of sort of reticulating kind of nested distinctions here. So there's religion, generally speaking, with these sub-attributes, and then the breakdown between organized religion, institutionalized religion, which bears all of these attributes listed above, institutions, ecclesiastica, and so on, and then inchoate popular religion, which for probably 98% of Chinese was the rule of thumb, basically, okay? And then further, beneath popular religion, this attribute of superstition and magic. And these distinctions all find translingual equivalents in Chinese that never existed before. So they're brought into the Chinese language with newly coined terms that are drawn from traditional Chinese lexicon, and they bring along with them the baggage of these distinctions. On the right-hand side, under the secular, we see science and technological process, civil society, grounded in a humanistic morality, and then this sort of teleological concept of social progress, which culminates in modernity and a modern society. So that's the thrust of the rational. And religion, whether it's going to be handmaiden to that destiny, depends on whether it's going to be amenable to a world that is defined as largely scientific, rational, and secular. So better get rid of your rituals really quickly and get morality. And basically, it's pretty much a Protestant-based distinction. And this is exactly what happened in Japan. I mean, you know, with this, if you look at academic literatures of this period, Buddhism is not a ritualistic tradition. If you look at traditions of practice, it was through and through. But we will not go into that at this point. Now, this is also connected with this, is a lateral sort of investigation across the world of different religious cultures and a gathering of data about this new category of religion, right? So if religion is a distinct yet universal dimension of human existence, is sort of now on the map as an analytic category, well, then you go looking for religions classified by sacred scriptures and religions classified by historical period and duration and religions classified by attribute. Are they animistic? Are they magical? Look at religions classified by nation, culture, race, you know? And sorting out of these sub-distinctions of the varieties of religion, okay? And that taxonomy then gets stacked vertically and linearly as a historical progress, okay? So what we see here is the taking of the assembling of those distinctions into what's described as a sort of evolution of religious consciousness or an evolution of religion. And this was the terminology of the day, right, to which Buddhists were forced to respond. So I won't go through the details here, but just take a look at the bottom. Primitive or natural religion, the earliest ancient stuff, you know, it still lingers around in certain margins of modern society, right? It's magic, it's ritualistic, it's animistic, it's polytheistic, it's tribal, it's inchoate, it's diffused. Not organized, it's just the day-to-day hand-to-mouth action, practices, and customs handed down to generations. Then we get ethnic distinctions by language or region, we get religions of the world, you know, in other words, looking broadly at religious types across the world and religious cultures, let's take an inventory of the different religions, you know, religious traditions that we find around ourselves. And then this question of world religions, and there's a fairly major transition here to the idea of religions, it's a misspelling, religions that purport to have a universal import or reach beyond a particular ethnicity or region or state, okay, or imperial tradition of some kind. And usually these are attributed to an inspired founder of some kind or another, not something that came from the gods or, you know, something from time immemorial, but someone like the Buddha. So this defines world religions that have more of a humanistic import rather than being connected with particular or regional languages and traditions. And then finally, you get this talk among religions about a world religion of and for modernity. The idea that is that few differences in humankind are being subsumed into this progress of modernization in a global human community, a humanity. What's the religion going to be and look like, right? And this is the you know the big fruit. This is the big goal here. So the language of world religion is spiritual, rationally moral, text-centered, socially progressive, individualistic, singular. If we're talking about a universal religion for a humanity, and we're not talking about humanities, but a humanity, a humankind, are we talking about a human religion? Right? Meaning if it's universal, is there to be just one? And then whose religion is that going to be? You see? Well, this poses tremendous problems, not just for Buddhists. This is a huge intellectual problem. But also for Buddhists among Buddhists, because it reticulates right down and becomes a question of, well, okay, I'm a Tibetan Buddhist or I'm a Shinshu Buddhist in Japan. What are we going to do with Zen Buddhists? You see, are they on the wagon as well, and how do we articulate that unity? Or are we moving beyond that altogether? So these were the stakes, and you can see that it's tied right to politics and property and possessions and ecclesiastica and religious rights and the whole business. So it's not a simply intellectual exercise. So I love this. This is sort of inspired by Jonathan Z. Smith, an article he did on, what is it, religions, religion, and the religious, which we probably all read. But in a way, evolution of religion in this stacked historical linear model is no evolution at all. You know? Though presented as evolutionary, the vertical line of religious types into a singular linear progression, with existing religions, cultures sort of assigned to different stages. You know, this one's primitive, this one's ethnic, this one's world, right? It actually freezes religious cultures in place in this new global discourse. Into taxonomical place. They become relics that are denied the possibility of further change themselves. So Buddhism is of a certain stage, Hinduism of a certain stage, and there it stays. You see what I mean? Unless it loses those defining attributes and becomes something completely different. So there's a religious survival of the fittest that not incidentally is all over the place in Japanese scholarship on religion of this period, addressed normatively as well. But it's bears mention that it's an analog to Herbert Spencer's evolution of social and political forms, which during this period of 1866 to 1900, there were multiple translations of his works into Japanese. There was an industry of interest in him during this period, apparently. So the question of Buddhism's evolutionary destiny and the place of different Buddhisms on the historical ladder is the real issue for Buddhists here. Whose tradition is the Buddhism of modernity? Because they're all on board with the modernity idea. So this is going to be the big issue at this point. So perhaps we don't need to spend much time on this one. Master narrative and the struggle for its control is this question, how Buddhists are going to define itself on this new grid, okay? And position itself in terms of the destinies of modernity. And what I want to do here is just unpack this for you by looking, by way of example, at three works, okay? In the center, on the left is Gyonen's original Essentials of the Eight Sects, which is produced in 1268, 13th century Japan. In the middle, an overview of the Ten Sects, which is a revision of Gyonen's work done by an ecumenical group in Japan under Jodo Shinshu leadership, Pure Land leadership in Japan, but translated into English also by Nanjo Bunyu, the one fellow who had studied at Oxford and was friends with Yang Wenhui. And then History of the 12 Sects on the right by Yang Wenhui, the Chinese reformer himself, okay, which is again based on Gyonen's model. Now the reason I'm choosing these two on the right, Nanjo's text and Yang's text, is because actually, as we'll see a little later, Yang and Nanjo were friends. they befriended one another at Oxford when Yang went away visited. They continued to exchange letters throughout most of their lives until they got really pissed off at each other, which I'll talk about also. And in fact, it was Nanjo Bunyu who was instrumental to all manner of lost Chinese Buddhist texts and newly printed Chinese Buddhist canons from Japan, being reintroduced from Japan back to China. And that caused quite a stir as well. So there is this lateral kind of cooperation there, collaboration, the project of modernity, albeit an uncomfortable one. Yang Wenhui, of course, was the fellow who established the first academies in China and whose model later academies, such as that of Taishu, were constructed. So here again, we get as an introduction, I won't go through the details here, this sort of sweeping overview of either Buddhist cosmology followed by, you know, the story of the life of the Buddha, the introduction of Buddhism, rise of Buddhism in India, and then its transmission through China, down through, you know, what occurs there, distinctive features, down to Japan. So it's got that combined historical and geographical vector to it. And the real question is going to be, what's going on with the staging of the relationships of these geographies, these geographical distinctions, and reference points, and this historical trajectory as well. Then is followed in section two of the work by point, laboriously going through the characteristics of each of however many sects are described in here. You know, and again, with reference points to India, to China, to Japan, and those histories and those philosophies. One distinction I want to point out to you is in Nanjo's text, something that appears that doesn't appear in Gyonen's text. Since Nanjo, of course, is writing much later, you know, centuries later than Gyonen, is a sub-distinction in the list of sects between first listing and discussing sects of the Nara period in Japan. You know, this is 7th through to 8th, 9th century, or down in the Heian, and then medieval sects of the Heian period, and then what he calls modern sects of the Kamakura period. Now, we could go into this a bit, but I'm going to restrain myself. I don't want to get you angry at me either. So, but modern sects, notice the use of the word modern for 13th century Japan, okay, which is a rather interesting distinction. So here's a layout of the sects that they enumerate and discuss. And I'm not going to go through the list. Here's the distinction between the medieval sects, the modern sects, the ancient sects, okay? But the color coding should show you it's all the same stuff. You know, they're just positioned a bit differently. So there are questions arise about that positioning. You know, how is it that they're arranged that way? Well, Gyonen, you know, these are all fairly consistent with one another, these first 7 or 8 or 9, you know? But some things are shifted around here and there. And what's most interesting is you get down to 8 here, the basic sects, which Gyonen was working with, and some that appear on the scene that we don't see earlier, such as the Pure Land traditions, the Zen school, sub-Pure Land traditions, and the Nichiren school. These are largely later Japanese developments that Gyonen was only minimally aware of at the time he was writing. Okay? Now, Gyonen's essentials, when you look at this text, you can see in the order that he presents them, you know, there's not only an emphasis to begin with. You can see that the first, say, 5 to appear are traditions that really originated in India and then found their way to China. And continued to persist through China and Japan. He identifies them as Hinayanist and Mahayanist, you know? So a qualitative distinction between them there, between great vehicle and lesser vehicle. And then when you get down to 6, 7, and 8, they're all Mahayanist, but in the last 6 and 7, this distinction, sub-distinction of the one Buddha vehicle, which seems to supersede the Mahayana, appears. And then you get down to 8, where esoteric Buddhism appears. And then you get down to the supplement, where he's not listing them as 8 sects yet, but here are 2 newcomers, Chan or Zen, and Pure Land, the originally out of China, but then developing very differently and quickly in Japan.
Okay.
So something's going on here. Now, Gyonen professes in his text that that there is no, that there is no particular qualitative order by which he's listing this. You know, squares up and down that that's the case. That it's just a convenient structure in which to work through this material, and there's no particular significance to this arrangement. But it's rather interesting that one of the editors of the early 20th century Japanese reprint of Gyonen says the following outright. He says, though Gyonen professes that the sects are listed according to no particular order, order is most definitely detected in his arrangement. Isn't that interesting? So this is the way people were reading the text. And indeed, it's been observed that the eight sects are in Gyonen's text are arranged according to something called the ten mentalities or perspectives, which is a normative schematic for doctrinal classification of the different Buddhist teachings, which begin with shallow and move to profound. They begin with Hinayana and end up with the one Buddha vehicle and esoteric Buddhism, and suggest a kind of progressive historical refinement of Buddhist teachings, a kind of evolving out of earlier and more primitive forms of Buddhism, higher, deeper, more pure form, resonance of the Buddha's message to the highest levels of the Buddhist teaching and what its true intention was. So there's a kind of soteriological sweep to these as well. So expedient, elementary, then progresses to advanced or true. India to Japan, the geographical move spectrum. Era of the Buddha to Heian, Kamakura, Japan. Can you see what's going on here? You know, we're getting a qualitative stacking of Buddhist traditions according to degree of expediency and reality or truth, and then that's being spread across a geography of India, China, Japan, and historical progress down to the Kamakura period of Japan. Okay. The short history of the 12 sects by Nanjo uses the same structure as Gyonen's text. Hierarchical classification purports to be replaced with a neutral historical framework of ancient, medieval, and modern. Modern here being 13th century Japan, Kamakura Japan. But hints of teleological trajectory and hierarchy remain. Jodo Shin and Nichiren schools, which are added to the list here, are the last culminating sects listed in this suite. And although they claim, and they, in their chapters, are presented as claiming historical primacy over the other schools. So, past and present, as the predestined fulfillment of a progressive revelatory unfolding of the Buddha's teaching. So, Nichiren, what is it saying here? Nichiren tradition in Japan and the Jodo Shin tradition, or Pure Land, true Pure Land tradition in Japan, were actually representing themselves as being a preordained, predestined, and even foretold revelatory culmination of of Shakyamuni Buddha's teaching. So that Shakyamuni Buddha was not preaching the core scriptures, foundational scriptures of these texts for people of his age, but preaching these texts and their message for people thousands of years later, where circumstances will have completely changed and the world was on a transitional, watershed between, the previous eras and a new era. So it was an era when foregoing traditions of Buddhism that had prevailed in earlier periods were rendered obsolete and in effect abrogated by the messages of the Nichiren and Pure Land schools. And according to the Nichiren and Pure Land schools in the more radical forms, where was this to take place? Can anybody answer that question? Japan. When was it to take place? 13th century, 12th and 13th century Japan, when these schools came on the scene. When was Gyonen's text written? 13th century Japan. When is the modern period? 13th century Japan. You see what's going on here? So you can pick it up here. It's easy to understand, see these as texts that, as a representation of Buddhist history, as an evolution that corresponds to the sweep from primitive societies to modern society. And then in fact, the Buddhism that would emerge with Nichiren school and with Jodo Shin schools during this period of time was a Buddhism destined for modernity. Okay? Rational, scientific, universal. Zen got on the bandwagon too. If you ever have a chance to read D.T. Suzuki's Introduction to Zen, Zen is presented quintessentially as the ur-mysticism. It's basically taps into the common elemental religious experience behind every inspired religion, which Suzuki calls the mystical experience, yet has the added benefit that it's not overly intellectualized, as Buddhism was in India, that it isn't turned over to a bunch of bureaucrats and painstaking bean counters and doctrine analysis, as Chinese did in China, but comes to the Japanese people who are simple, poetic, natural, and in coming into contact with Zen, bring out its true and profound message as a disciplined, rational mysticism. You have to figure that one out. A mysticism that's not capricious, but that can be inculcated by cultivation and therefore spread to humankind as a universal religion. Same story, okay? Where do Chinese fit to this scheme? They've still got Buddhist. Buddhist tradition disappeared out of India long ago, but where does this leave Chinese Buddhists? Of whom any number were good friends of Nanjo Bunyo and other scholars. Well, the issue here is, you know, well, they're in China to begin with, so it's not Japan, tough luck. But they're in China and they're privy to versions of those traditions who have not perhaps reached their historical destiny. Does this make sense to you, according to this scheme? Okay. Well, last text, same story, but even more pronounced. This is the French translation and really an elaboration of Nanjo's text on the 12 sects. And it's quite explicit. It's written by a man named Fujishima Ryoen, and he himself was a Jodo Shinshu priest who had visited and studied in France, and he rewrote this text and produces a very, very clear story. He represents Jodo Shinshu, his tradition, at the end of this narrative, represents the final predestined unfolding of the Buddhist teaching, and it renders obsolete all other earlier Buddhist schools and teachings subordinated to. It's a religion of national faith, spirituality, and morality. Buddhism disappeared long ago in India, was once vital in China, but since has become corrupted and entered into decline. And only in Japan has Buddhism continuously flourished and reached its culmination. Okay? So only to Japan can we assign the name true or orthodox Buddhism. So you can see the tensions emerging among different Buddhist parties here. This discourse takes hold in this age. Chinese obviously reacted with dismay. It ended the friendship of Yan Wenwei and Nanjo Bunyu unnaturally. Yan Wenwei writes in the preface about the Hasshu Koyo. I love this passage. He says, if you read this, he says to students, when students wade into this text, meaning Hasshu Koyo, with its very particular narrative scenario, and begin to make comparisons, they should take care not to enter as lord and master and exit as slave. So he's really reacting and responding to what he sees as an aggressive hegemonic discourse in his text. Ding Fu Bao, who wrote a preface to Yang, a very famous scholar in China, wrote a preface to Yang's text for beginning students. The teachings of Dharma holistically interfuse with one another, and in their interfusion, they are collectively sublime. And people are given to bias grasping, and through bias grasping, the teachings become mutually conflicting. The problem arises from the inability to integrate the different schools, which causes them to become as mutually repellent as fire and water. You know, so there's a real resistance to in Chinese mindset of this period, and probably now historians show us that this synthetic or kind of holistic style of thinking about adopted variant Buddhist doctrines and teachings and texts. That discourse of kind of harmonious interfusion is actively present in intellectual culture and Buddhism in China, probably as early as 15th and 16th century. So it's very much established part of the Buddhist landscape in China. And so clearly they're very much, you know, sensitive to and in opposition to the strict linear historical development and sectarian differentiations found among the Japanese versions of Gyonen. So last person says, each school, for the most part, denigrates other schools and lauds the superiority of its own for beginning students. This is very problematic. So they don't like the message that's being sent. Okay. So Yang Wei basically, in his texts, completely turns the narrative around. He's again listing 10 sects or so, but he's positioning them differently and giving them a different narrative flow. Okay. So he places first the Vinaya school or teaching, and places Pure Land last, as Japanese had done. But there's a major difference here. What this is set up for is a soteriological path or narrative. And the emphasis is on integral complementarity of the 10 schools, right? So he says, the foregoing 9 schools prior to the last one, Pure Land, individually accommodate the myriad capacities, the different cultural backgrounds and capacities and abilities and inclinations of different human beings, okay? Capacities. Regardless of the particular teaching that one pursues, Hinayana, Mahayana, different versions of the Mahayana, India, China, Japan. So it's regardless of the particular teaching, they all serve as provisions for rebirth in the Pure Land, you know? This destiny of rebirth in the spiritual paradise after death, where anyone can go via these teachings. Okay? As such, the 9 schools enter into this one culminating school or end of the Pure Land. And upon rebirth in the Pure Land, each and every teaching of Dharma is apprehended in its integral totality. So even Pure Land disappears once you enter Pure Land, because you've apprehended the sort of universal, unchanging message and truth of the Buddha himself. Thus, the one school or teaching of the Pure Land enters the 9, and they interfuse without obstruction. It's a very, very different interfusing holistic model from this historically progressive and evolutionary one of the other texts. Now, this is just a little footnote to the relationship between Yang Wenhui and the Jodo Shinshu in Japan that brings home just how serious some of these distinctions were. In 1875, the Jodo Shinshu, bent on its modernizing, universalizing, missionizing, you know, message, initiates a mission in Shanghai, which was led by Oberusu Kocho, one of the very men who wrote one of the sweeping texts I mentioned earlier. He's also a man who had become a personal friend of Yang Wenhui and knew Nanjo Bunyu quite well. In 1876, Oberusu writes a text called Basics of Shinshu Teaching in Chinese, which he circulates to potential Chinese converts. It's a really interesting text. He also befriends Nanjo Bunyu in 1878 and 84. They arrange for copies of lost Chinese texts to be introduced to Japan, or reintroduced from Japan back to China. Now, among those lost texts was a commentary by a Chinese master known as Shandao, who lived in the 8th century, to an important Pure Land Sutra. That text had been lost fairly early in China, but had a major impact in Japan, and was probably one of the seminal texts from which Pure Land and Jodo Shinshu traditions found theological basis and evolved. Are you following my reasoning here? It's a Chinese text by a Chinese master that ends up in Japan, and it paves the way and is a holy text of the Jodo Shinshu, okay? But long gone from Japan, China, which can only also signal that, you know, Chinese Buddhist traditions had gone to pot by this time and were in decline. When Chinese get this text and reread it, they see a completely different message in it from the one that's promulgated by the interpretation from the one promulgated by the Jodo Shinshu, and especially from the one promulgated in Ogurusu's missionizing, short missionizing tract he wrote. Controversies erupt between Chinese Buddhists and Japanese Shinshu priests over the interpretation of Shandao's teaching. Right at the same time, the Jodo Shinshu mission had by this time already subsumed some 30 Buddhist monasteries in China that had fallen on decline and turned them into Jodo Shinshu institutions. So there's a bit of alarm among Buddhists during this period. This is the same period where we're beginning to see the government seizing Buddhist properties in China as well. So a Shinshu mission is then established in Nanjing, which was Yang Honghui's own town. And an open ideological conflict develops between the two, and that's pretty much the end of it. All right, we part ways, and that's it. But going back to Yang's interesting model of the, this interfusing world of Buddhist teachings and traditions, right? That he sees culminating this image of a pure land that is inclusive of all messages and culminating of all messages, very different from, and is largely timeless and geared to the idea of capacity and synthesis. Remember also that he was a man struggling to revive Buddhism in his period, a man struggling to come to grips with the institutional social changes that were taking place, was bent on popularizing and modernizing Buddhism in the image of Western universities and institutions to bring it into the modern age. So he's just as much driven by that goal as others. So I'd like to just finish with this rather amusing passage in which he gives us his updated modern representation of the Pure Land as he sees it. And bear in mind that this is the model, probably a representation, that may well have influenced Sheng Yan's own drive and ambition to build a Buddhist university in Taiwan, really the first of its kind, as well as to teach Westerners such as myself and establish centers in the United States, and to seek academic education himself. Yang says, among persons today who are intellectually discerning, there are none who do not give utmost importance to places of learning. To borrow the simile, the Western Pure Land is simply the epitome of universities. That's the metaphor for him. Amitabha greets and draws living beings there from every direction so they can pursue study. He supplies them with meals and clothing. Tuition is not required. Take note. Nor does he set a quota on the number of students admitted or their age. The grounds and facilities of the campus are themselves of unfathomable size, and if you're a constrained property university, you'll understand what that means. Their dimensions utterly without limit. Persons who enter his school, regardless of their ability, eventually achieve the assurance of the unoriginated nature of the Dharma, that is, the highest realization that births the wisdom of a Buddha or Buddhahood, on the Bodhisattva path. It's the watershed experience of guaranteed future Buddhahood. And to put it in the most absolute terms possible, all the manifold teachings of the 10 directions and 3 periods are replete there without exception. Hence, among all the Buddhas, there is none, not one who does not sing its praises. So there you have it, The taking of this ancient, archaic idea of rebirth in Amitabha's Western Pure Land and re-envisioning that in the image of a modern university, but one that is freed of all its limitations of capacity and size and inability to teach. So transforming the world, even free of geographical location and limits. Okay. So that's the end of my talk. This brings us back to Master Sheng Yan, and just out of courtesy of him, this is a shot up above of his diploma from the Buddhist Academy at Jing'an Monastery, Shanghai, where he might have read this very passage. And this is his class graduation photo from 1948. So, thank you, folks.
If anyone have questions, we can entertain a few questions before we conclude.
You don't have to, by the way.
Okay. fascinated by Yang Wenhui's 12 sects, that chart. It doesn't have Chan.
Doesn't it?
And
maybe not. I wonder why.
Of course, the teleological ending is different. One, the previous two ending in Japan, Gyonen and Nanju Bunyo, and Yang Wenhui is ending in China.
Yeah. That's interesting.
That's where you have the three texts side by side. The one before this. But even in that one, here you see the Yang Wenhui's text
in
China.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then the next slide.
It'd be interesting to go back and see that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The next sect.
The next slide has them, doesn't it?
Doesn't have the. China. Oh, I see it.
Yeah, it's there.
Number
it's
eight.
It's hard to see. It's number eight.
I see.
And it has Sheng and it has Jyotoshu. It doesn't have Nichiren.
Yeah. No.
Which would make sense. I mean, it doesn't go that far. That's an interesting distinction.
Go back to the other slide, behind this one.
Behind this one?
Previous there.
Yeah.
I'm just curious, just choreographically, the structures of these texts. Gyonen's text, you have here listing an overview of Buddha's teaching as the first section of the text.
Right.
There's no cosmology in that at the beginning?
I'd have to go back and look. You know, there is a sort, but from what I recall offhand, it's been a while since I've looked at it, it's really a discussion about the relationship of expediency to reality and the relationship of expediency and reality to capacity. You know, human ability is the, you know, functional basis on which those distinctions of expediency are made, you know. So time is sort of subsumed into that as well. And I don't think there's discussion of cosmology in terms of the six realms of rebirth, you know, the supramundane.
Well, is that what's going on?
That's what's going on in some of the others. It's a basic layer.
They don't take it even further back.
Yeah, yeah.
The kind of more cosmic time.
Yeah, and you know, Buddha lands elsewhere, some other things like that as well. Yeah, and also, you know, prior Buddhas and so forth, you know. So it's a little, as I recall, it's more emphasis into that. There are some other aspects of Gyonen's text that are kind of interesting as well, but you know, I just didn't dwell on them for sake of brevity.
And you had mentioned on this text that it began to get printed in the 1800s.
When it started to get reprinted again, yeah. Seems to have largely been a manuscript tradition, but there clearly
there was a printing.
There clearly was one, maybe two printings, as I recall, in the 1600s. You know, and there's not much evidence of impact there, you know, or whether just the documentary record is lost now. Don't know, you know, but it's maybe just that one shot, you know. For 300 years, not much. Manuscript tradition, of which a few exemplars exist, not many, you know. And who found it? Rediscovered it is a question I'd love to know more about, you know.
And whether or not this structure, this kind of historiographical framework of a text is unique to
Gyonen? No, I mean, he wrote another text that also is a kind of, just largely is a history across three continents, you know, of India, China, and Japan. We'd have to go back, and I can't really answer in all honesty. I'm not that familiar with this, you know, with the literatures of this period of you know, in Buddhist circles in Japan. There's always been an awareness, even from the very beginning of Buddhism in China, that of transmission from an earlier period, Buddha in India, issues of authenticity and legitimacy. So, you know, that narrative sweep has been part of its historical imagination from the moment it arrived in East Asia. And certain works got produced in China on that basis, you know, certain works got produced in Japan. Yeah. So it's there, you know. Yeah. Yes?
So, it's very interesting to see all the jockeying going on.
Oh, yeah, I thought so too.
And
yeah.
What is it like now, several generations later, with the relationship between the Japanese Buddhism and the Chinese Buddhism?
a lot of it depends on who you talk to. And there are some issues on which they're fine, you know? I mean, and Sheng Yan himself was a great example of having spent a considerable time in Japan, becoming great friends with Japanese scholars and so forth. There are some messages you sort of steer away from. In Japan, there's been a lot of sort of revisionist thinking about the impact of this sort of narrative, particularly in the war years and afterwards, you know, as kind of feeding into Japanese militarism and being complicit in that in some regards. And among Buddhists, and I've known quite a few who have themselves talked about that, and some traditions more than others have really made that a major point of discussion. And I think things are much more relaxed now than they were some decades earlier. Yeah. But this was a particularly tense period. Right? Yeah. This makes sense. I always worry, it's like totally overwhelming. You know, as I look at it myself, I go, oh my God, how am I going to survive this? But
it's great. All right. Thank you.